Bibles here. We're over here to 1 John. We're going to continue our Bible study as we're going through this book here. We only interrupt it when we are on special days or things like that. Then we deviate from it, as we will here coming up in Father's Day here coming up. But in 1 John chapter 3, that's in the back of your Bible here. And right before here, there's Jude, and then 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and then Jude, and then Book of Revelation. So it's right toward the back. In 1 John chapter 3, as we continue on here now, we would like to begin here in verse 2 and read on down. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doeth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Well, we know this here from verse 3, that when Jesus Christ, and he could come at any moment. If he should come today, then we're going to be changed in a moment, a twinkling of an eye. But realizing that Jesus Christ could come at any moment, we ought to have ourselves prepared by living the kind of life that Jesus Christ wants us to live. You know, there's so many people, and that sort of amazes me. I remember when we were first saved, the preacher came to the house, and Margie would run for the bedroom. Time to change out of the slacks and get into a dress. And, you know, we were looking around. Is there any books here that shouldn't be here? You know, we want Christian books. Like the preacher came one time and to a house, and the mother told her daughter, said, go in the living room and get the book we love the most. Came back with Sears catalog. And, you know, hoping it would be the Bible, you know. But anyway, if we're looking for Jesus Christ, and as we get a little older in life, we begin to put a value on our life more than just pleasure, more than just fulfilling our lust and so forth like that. There is a value in other people, and we can have an influence upon their lives. And remember this, faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. The most precious person on the face of this earth was the man that came down and told me that I was a sinner, I needed Jesus Christ, and if I trust him, I would go to heaven when I died. Very precious person. And so is that to you and anyone else. So God uses you and I to do that. Now we come on down to verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. Well, that was the Old Testament law there that gave the basic moral code and so forth and our obligations to God, even under the Ten Commandments along with many other laws that were given. So when I sin, I do things that transgresses the law, most assuredly, assuredly does. You might put a reference down to that in Romans chapter 7, verse 8 to 13, and also chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. In fact, we'll go over there just a second here to Romans chapter 2, verse 14 and 15, because it tells us even without the law, God has borne in us to know the things to do things right. He says here in verse 14, for when the Gentiles which have not the law do by nature the things contained in the law, these having not the law are a law unto themselves. So even if you don't know anything about the Bible, you know it's wrong to steal. You know it's wrong to lie. You know it's wrong to hurt somebody. You know that. It's born in you because you don't want anybody doing that to you. So you know it's wrong. Even though you don't have to read it in the Bible, which the Bible tells us in Ephesians, we shouldn't steal, we shouldn't lie, we shouldn't do those things anymore. It's wrong. Sure, we know that. So we're not guiltless before that, you see. Now, we find out also in verse 5. Let's go on down. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Now, first of all, the eternal punishment of sin is hell. If we sin after we're a Christian, we never have to pay the eternal punishment for sin. Christ did that on the cross. You'll never go to hell for any sin you ever commit after you're a Christian. Christ made that payment. Does that mean that I'm free then to sin? Absolutely not. God forbid. Does it mean if I run a traffic light and the policeman stops me, all I have to do is tell him I'm a Christian and he voids the ticket? Well, I don't think so. Does it mean that when I sin down here that I don't have to pay a price for it? Absolutely not. You don't have to go to hell for it because Christ paid that penalty, the eternal penalty. But yes, we have to pay the price for breaking the law in society. Absolutely. We sure do. Now, there's a law in marriage. If I say, Margie, do this, I tell you right now, I've done broken the law. If I say, Margie, would you like to do this? She responds. Usually. But if I order my wife to do something, I'll tell you right now, hang it up because it isn't going to work. Now, if she says, Max, do this. I don't know what it is, but it just sort of wells up a rebellion in you. If she says, honey, if you get time, would you mind doing this for me? It's as good as done. It's a matter of, now there's some just basic laws in living that if you apply, they work. But anyway, as we go on, let's go on down here. It says here, you know that he was manifest to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. So as I read the Bible, I begin to find out what God wants me to do. And sometimes people will come and they'll say, you know, well, what is sin? Just hold your place, go left in your Bible to James, all right? Let's go right back here to the book of James, all right? Go to James chapter 4 and verse 17, sort of a silly question. People ask that because they usually want an excuse to do something they know is wrong and want you to say it's not wrong, you know, and let them do it. In verse 17 it says, therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Now all of this John is leading on down to, and we're going to show you something. In verse 5, and you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Now, we come on down to verse 6, and you want to get your pencil out, because you want to write this down here, because there's two key words here. In verse 6, it says, whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Now, we hear Christians, and I get a little upset at this. I hear Christians say, you know, oh, even when we're serving the Lord, we sin. No, you're not. No, you are not sinning when you serve the Lord. Now, you still have the old sin nature, but if you're not obeying the old sin nature, you're not sinning. Oh, I'm a sinner. I think they do this on a false sense of piety or something. Well, I'm still sinning even though I'm serving the Lord. No, you're not, because the Bible says, whosoever abideth in him, that means listening to the Lord, doing what the Lord wants us to do, in him sinneth not. No, if I'm serving the Lord, I'm not sinning. I'm not sinning now, preaching the Bible. Now, I may after church, but I'm not doing it now, and I hope I don't do it after church. But when I'm serving the Lord, I'm not sinning. You see, whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Now, you need to write these two words down, for in the Greek here, they are, it makes quite a difference here. So when he tells us here, in verse 6, whosoever here hath not seen him. Seen is the Greek word horo. And that's H-O-R-A-O. Horio. Now the definition of horio in the Greek means to discern clearly, to attend to, behold, perceive, see, or take heed to. Now, what he's saying does not mean, well, of course I've never seen Jesus Christ personally, no man's seen him. But what does it mean, have not seen? I have not really, really discerned clearly at all. Whosoever sinneth, I've not really discerned clearly of what I'm doing to Christ. I've not really discerned clearly of what I'm doing to my testimony. I've not really discerned clearly. I've backed away from the Lord a little bit too far and not really close enough to him to really realize what I'm doing to my church, what I'm doing to myself, what I'm blowing my testimony to other people, and that's what this word means in the Greek. So whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, has not discerned clearly what the consequences are going to be and what it's going to do. Neither knowing him. That does mean I cease to be a Christian when I sin. But knowing him is another Greek word, gnosko, G-I-N-O-S-K-O, gnosko. Now, the gnosko in the Greek has a great variety of applications concerning. It's a form of a prime verb to know absolutely. It means beware, perceive, be resolved, be sure, and understand. So, how it would really read would be here. Whosoever abideth in him doesn't sin. And that's what God wants us to do. Abide in him, abide in Christ. Read his word, obey his word, and do what God tells us to do as a Christian. But whosoever sinneth, as a still a Christian, hath not discerned clearly, neither has known absolutely or understood Christ. Yes, I know I'm going to heaven, but do I really understand that it takes away the blessings of God? It can put me under the chastening of the Lord? Rob me of the blessings I could have had? Do I really understand that? Or do I think I can just go ahead as a Christian and do anything I want to do and not pay a price for it? Now, the price is not eternal hell, because Christ died on the cross to pay that. Just get that in your mind. Doesn't matter what you do after you're a Christian, you don't have to go to hell for it. But you do have to pay a price for it. For the Christian, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, we suffer loss of rewards, plus we suffer loss of blessings down here, plus we suffer loss of our testimony. And that's hard to get back sometimes. So that's what it's speaking about, John's laying all this in line for the Christian now to discern. Now let's go on down here to verse 7. Little children, let no man deceive you. Now he's calling the Christians here, just little children, whether they're young, old, or anything. It's just a generic term here, little children, because we are the children of God. Remember John 1:12, as many as received him, to them gave he the right to become the children of God, even to them that believe on his name. Let no man deceive you, for he that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. Well, what is that righteousness? Well, first of all, it's not just living in open sin. But what is really the righteousness? Let's go back here to chapter 2 and verse 29. We know here, it tells us in chapter 2, verse 29, if you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. What is that righteousness? Well, we find out righteousness is, first of all, standing against the false teachers that he's talking about here in chapter 2. That's what he's talking about. Notice here in verse 26. It says here, these things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you, that want to lead you astray, that want you to do things against what the Lord wants you to do. Notice in verse 22. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. So, when I stand for the Lord, then I'm doing righteousness, and it's proof that I'm born of him, because I'm not denying the Father or the Son. You see, he brings this, interweaves this all the way down here, which is also inclusive of not only what we stand for, but what also how we live. Now, let's go on down. It's sort of interesting. Now we get to verse 8. And this we're going to center on just a little bit, because this affects our Christian life. In verse 8 it says, he that committeth sin is of the devil. Now you're saying, am I now the child of the devil? It doesn't say that. The sin that any Christian or anybody else commits is of the devil. You're saying, well, he loves to sin. He loves to see you sin. He loves to see you blow your testimony. He loves to do that. Anything he puts in, I'm just going to show you some things here in a minute. So he that committeth sin is of the devil does not mean you're a child of the devil. It just means you're doing what the devil wants you to do. That's what it means. It's referring to being under the influence of the devil or controlled by Satan through the old nature. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. Beginning of what? You remember when God created Adam and Eve? And who was the first one on the spot? Satan. And the first thing he says to the woman, he said, hath God said? Hath God said? And then, hath God said that you should? Well, he knew God said. But he made him question what God said. Made him Eve question what God said. And then it goes on to say, hath he said you shouldn't eat of the fruit and so forth there? And after she answered, said, no, we can eat of everything in the garden but this one tree in the midst of the garden. And then he said, well, you know why? It's because if you eat of that tree, you'll become as gods. In other words, to know good and evil. Well, she already knew good because God said, if you don't eat of it, you're good. She already knew that, so he lied to her, didn't he? He questioned God's word, he lied to her, and so forth. And he said, if you eat of it, you're not going to die. But God said, the day that you eat of thereof, thou shalt surely die. So he lied again, didn't he? He'll do that exactly to you. He knows every trick in the book to ruin your life. So if I sin, and what he says here, he that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. Beginning of mankind here upon the earth, he's never stopped. He has tried to ruin every person that God's ever created because it's an attack upon God and his creation. If he can ruin your life, or he can deceive you by believing there's some other way to heaven except faith in Jesus Christ. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil, which he did when he rose from the dead. And not only that, he gave us the Holy Spirit, and greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Now, let's get some examples of this. First of all, as we've said, when Eve was in the garden, Satan took over right immediately, attacked her right there. Too bad her husband wasn't there. Adam, you shouldn't have left her alone. You should have come running and said, "Get out of here, buddy." I remember one time, Marge and I, we were having a little tough time making it. We were in our early life, and I said, "Whatever you do, don't buy anything from a door-to-door salesman." And I'll be darned, she didn't buy a vacuum cleaner from one. She bought it one day, and I sold it back to him the next. Don't you ever do that again. Now, you set up appointment when I'm here, not when he's here. And boy, he fed her a line, I tell you, and this was a super-duper deal. And he had her convinced everything he was going to pay her to take it. We had me in debt for 2 years. I got that back to him. What are you saying? Pretty slick. Satan is one slick dude. Now, let me ask you something. Now, we go to John 8:44, and God tells us there, and by the same gospel John wrote, he said, Satan is a murderer and a liar. Boy, and he is a liar. He always lied to you. Now, let me ask you something. When on the missionary journey there, when John Mark went with Paul, and then he bailed out at Perga. Find out he bailed out in Acts chapter 13. He left the group. He left the missionary group. And he went back to Jerusalem. Now, let me ask you something. Who had the influence over John Mark to do that? Did God want him to quit, or did Satan influence him? Satan influenced him because through the old nature. Said, John Mark, you need to, you can't do this. So he left him, bailed out. Paul didn't want to take him back. Him and Barnabas had quite a battle and disagreement over whether they're going to take him back. Later, Paul did, but not right away. What about Lot, who gravitated towards Sodom in Genesis chapter 19? Lot was a Christian. The Word of God tells us that while in Sodom, he vexed his righteous soul from day to day, and you can't find a righteous thing about him. He even offered his two daughters to prostitute them so that the men who were Sodomites would not pursue the visitors that God had sent him. Who would motivate a man, a Christian man, to offer his daughters to these Sodomites? Man! Was that Satan? Of course it was. Paul was told not to go to Jerusalem, but he went there anyway, did he not? He surely did. Got arrested, so forth. Who told Paul, even the great apostle Paul, wrote 14 of the 27 books of the Bible, Paul disobeyed the Lord, got him in all kind of trouble. Now, who told Saul to go ahead and go toward Jerusalem? Well, Satan worked on his thing. He said, them people need to be saved. You need to go there. You need to go. God said, don't go to Jerusalem. So you have the Holy Spirit, and you had a satanic spirit. And in that particular case, Paul did what? He disobeyed the Lord. Who was behind it? Satan. Surely was. When Peter denied Christ three times in Matthew chapter 26, and he had just said, he said, Lord, I don't care how many forsake you or deny you, don't worry about me, I'll die for you. It was a few hours later. A few hours later, he denied Christ three times. Well, what made him scared? Satan. Don't witness to anybody because they may laugh at you. Well, he denied him three times. That was Satan that did that. David committed murder and adultery in 2 Samuel chapter 11 and chapter 12. Let me ask you something. David was one of the greatest kings there ever was. But at a moment of time, Satan knew exactly David should have been out leading the army, and he wasn't where he should have been. He was out on the deck there, and he looks across there, and he sees Bathsheba. Bathsheba's out there, and man, she is a beautiful woman. What did Satan appeal to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of thinking, can I get another man's wife? So man, he entered into Satan's mind, this woman's beautiful, you're the king. David conspired to send Uriah, her husband, to the front lines, have the troops withdraw, and got him killed. Satan is a murderer, isn't he? And he is a liar, isn't he? And he deceived one of the greatest kings that Israel ever had. Another interesting thing. In Matthew chapter 16, Christ had just told Peter and the disciples, he said, I'm going to the cross and I'm going to die. Peter said, Lord, not so. I don't want you to do that. The Lord said, I'd just like for you to hold this here because we'll show you how he works here. Go to Matthew chapter 16 for just a second here. Matthew chapter 16 in your Bible. And well, it's very interesting what the Lord told him here. Matthew chapter 16, I'd like for you to notice here, in verse 21 to 23, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. And he turned and he said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan. Well, was Peter Satan? No. Was he under the influence of Satan? Absolutely. Who put it into his mind? Because Satan did not want Christ to go to the cross. He did not want Christ. That's why he had all the children killed under Herod. There in Matthew chapter 1. He'd kill all those children. I don't even go to the cross. He may some way be raised from the dead, which Christ was. So he was raised from the dead. Therefore assuring you, you have eternal life. That's sort of interesting. Now we come to, if you want to write this down, Luke chapter 22. The Lord told Peter, he said, Do you know that Satan hath desired to have you and to sift you? He surely has. He'd love to sift you and he'd love to ruin you. And he'd love to get you into trouble. He'd love to make a disgrace out of your life. He would love to do this and love to do that. Go with me to another example here. Let's go to Acts chapter 5. Okay. Acts chapter 5. Okay. Here we go. Acts chapter 5, and here's a perfect example of this. Acts chapter 5, and notice here, if you will, in verse 1. But a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart or your conscience to lie to the Holy Ghost? Now, here was a conflict between the Holy Ghost that wanted them to do that, and here was Satan trying to say, no, you don't have to do that. And Ananias listened to what Satan had put into his mind and said not to do and kept back part of the price of the land, and God just killed him dead, just took him dead. Can Satan influence you? He surely can. And I want to take time to do something, so you have to follow with me here if we can get this in. Let's go in our Bibles here back to the book of Job. And I want to show you how tricky this old buzzard is. And he really is. If you go back here to the book of Job here, and you begin to find in Job chapter 1. Now, you're going to have to follow because I want to get this in here this morning. And I think I can if you'll follow along with me. Job is before jump. No, I'm just kidding you. It's before Psalms. Jump from Psalms to Job. Okay, go left in your Bible. Open your Bible, turn it into the middle, allow for the concordance, and go left. And you should hit Psalms. Okay? If that fails, punt. No, I'm just saying, if that fails, try the index. Okay, here we go. Over to Job chapter 1, okay? We're going to find out what this is all about Job, okay? Chapter 1, notice here in verse 6 to 8. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And Satan came also among them, and the Lord said unto Satan, Whence comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord, and he said, From going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. He doesn't miss a thing. He's not running. He's walking. He's got his eyes open. And the Lord said unto Satan, Hast thou considered my servant Job? For there is none liketh him in the earth. Get this now. A perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil. Okay, just keep that in mind. That's the premise. So we got a description of who Job was, and he was a righteous man, He didn't like evil. God thought he was a perfect man, which means he was a complete man. He obeyed what the Lord wanted him to do. Now he's got three buddies. One of those buddies is the name of Eliphaz. We find out that God had allowed Satan to go ahead and put sores on him and so forth, but you can't take his life. He's under the protective care of God. But you can test him. You can do this. So when all of that happened, and he lost his possessions, and he was in a sick and everything else, here comes his three buddies. So here comes a buddy by the name of Eliphaz. Eliphaz is supposed to be his buddy. Eliphaz has a dream. Notice here in verse 1. All right, verse 1 and 2. In chapter 4. Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered, and he said, "If we essay to commune with thee," that's Job, "wilt thou be grieved?" Job, will it grieve you? "But who can withhold himself from speaking?" Man, I can't contain myself. I got all the answers, Job. I'll tell you what your problem is. Go with me to 12 and 16. Now, I just picked out the highlights of this. In verse 12, he says, "Now, a thing was secretly brought to me. Satan gave him a dream." You think Satan can't implant dreams? He surely can. He said, "A thing was secretly brought to me, and my ear received a little thereof. And in thoughts from the visions of the night," that's the dream, "when deep sleep falleth upon men." This is what Eliphaz is telling Job now. "And fear came upon me, and trembling, which made all of my bones shake." Oh, it's just scary. "Then a spirit passed before my face. The hair of my flesh stood up." And it stood still, "but I could not discern the form thereof. An image was before my eyes. There was silence, and I heard a voice saying." So, we find out Eliphaz had a dream. Now, we're going to find out as he relates that. Now, go with me to chapter 5. Chapter 5. Eliphaz is still talking here, all right? Chapter 5, verses 1 to 3. Here we go. Just follow along with me. "Call now, if there be any that will answer thee," he's talking to Job, "of which of the saints wilt thou turn? For wrath killeth the foolish man, and envy slayeth the silly one." Now, he's telling Job, this is you, old buddy. This is you. "For I have seen the foolish taking root, but suddenly I cursed his habitation." So he's telling Job, "You're all this come upon you because you're a bad boy. You've done things wrong." Notice in verse 8 and 9. "I would seek unto God, and unto God would I commit my cause." He's telling Job, this is what you need to do, Job, "which doeth great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number." So Eliphaz has given Job all this advice. Now it's what you need to do. Now, is the advice wrong? Nope. The advice is right. The only problem is he's giving the advice to the wrong person. Satan says, "Tell him what God says." Satan uses God's word, but he applies it to the wrong boy. And he appears in a dream to Eliphaz, says, "This is Job's problem." And he uses the word of God to apply it to Job when Job was innocent. Wasn't to be applied at all. But let's go on down now and see this. All right, sort of interesting here. In verse 17, "Behold, happy is the man whom God correcteth, and therefore despisest thou not the chastening of the Almighty." So Eliphaz says, God's correcting you. Don't despise the chastening of the Almighty. Now, is that right? Is that the word of God? Absolutely, that's the word of God. It's all through there. God does correct those that are disobedient. Yeah, don't despise it. He says the same thing in Hebrews. Doesn't he? He surely does. Now go with me to verse 27. "Lo, this, we have searched it, so it is. Hear it, and know thou it for thy good." Listen to what I'm saying, Job. It's for your own good. I got the answers to it. All right. Let's get Job's answer. Go with me to chapter 6 in verse 14 and 15. In verse 4:15, and now this is Job answering Eliphaz. "To him that is afflicted, pity should be showed from his friend. But he forsaketh the fear of the Almighty." And he's saying, Eliphaz, to him that is afflicted, pity should be shown to me. "My brethren have dealt deceitfully as a brook, as the streams of brooks, they pass away. They dry up," and so forth. Now notice in chapter 7, verse 13 and 15. Chapter 7, I'm just hitting highlights here, in verse 13. "When I say, my bed shall comfort me, my couch shall ease my complaint, then thou, Eliphaz, you scarest me with dreams, and terrifiest me through visions, so that my soul chooses strangling and death rather than my life." How'd you like to have friends like that? Now we come on down. We begin to see what Eliphaz says back to Job. Go with me to chapter 15. Go with me to chapter 15. All right? In verse 5 and 6. Eliphaz, in chapter 15 and verse 5, says this, "For thy mouth uttereth thine iniquity, and thou choosest the tongue of the crafty." Says Job, "You're pretty crafty, old boy. Thine own mouth condemneth thee, and not I. Yea, thine own lips testify against thee." Notice in verse 16 and 17, "How much more abominable and filthy is man, which drinketh iniquity like water? I will show thee, hear me, and that which I have seen I will declare." In other words, I got this in a dream. Satan filled him full of dreams. But you know, Satan was so slick, he told the truth about God. But it didn't apply to Job. Remember, Job was a perfect man that walketh upright and escheweth evil. Satan's a pretty tricky old boy, isn't he? Now let's go to Job chapter 16, verse 1 to 5. Here we go. In Job chapter 16, Job answers him back. And he answered and he said, "I have heard many such things. Miserable comforters are you all. Shall vain words have an end? Or what emboldeneth thee that thou answereth? I also could speak as you do. If your soul were in my soul's stead, I could heap up words against you and shake my head at you. But I would strengthen you with my mouth, and the moving of my lips should assuage your grief." In other words, I wouldn't do to you what you're doing to me, you know, at all. None whatsoever. Then it's sort of interesting here. We come over here to chapter 23. Go with me to chapter 23. Okay, we're just hitting the highlights here now, but I just want to show you how tricky Satan does. All came to Eliphaz through this satanic dream. Chapter 23. Job again. Here we go. Or if we take chapter 22, let's get one more here from Eliphaz, okay? Chapter 22 and verse 1. "Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered, and he said..." Go down to verse 5. "For thou hast taken a pledge from thy brother," and he falsely accuses Job now, "for naught, and stripped the naked of their clothing." Job never did that. "Thou hast not given water to the weary to drink, and thou hast withholden bread from the hungry. But as for the mighty men, he had the earth, and the honorable man dwelt in it. Thou hast sent widows away empty, and the arms of the fatherless have been broken. And therefore snares are round about thee, and sudden fear troubleth thee." Now that's what Eliphaz says to Job, but none of it was true. Now Satan not only used part of the word of God, but now he tells a lie about Job to Eliphaz for Eliphaz to relate it to Job. All of this from a satanic dream. Job chapter 23, go to verse 10. Job chapter 23 and verse 10. Notice up here what he says. In verse 10 here to 12. But this is Job speaking now, okay? "But he knoweth the way that I take, and when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. My foot hath held his steps, his way have I kept, and not declined. Neither have I gone back from the commandments of his lips. I have esteemed thy words, the words of his mouth, more than my necessary food." Now, that's sort of interesting. Now, we're going to see the end of the whole thing. Go with me to chapter 42 here, and we're going to find out what God says to Eliphaz, and because Eliphaz believed a satanic dream. Go with me to Job chapter 42, and let's begin to look here in verse 7 and 8. All right, just hit the highlights of it here. Now, this is God here speaking here to Eliphaz. "And it was so," in verse 7, "that after the Lord had spoken these words unto Job, the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, My wrath is kindled against thee and against thy two friends, for you have not spoken of me the right thing that is right, or the thing that is right, as my servant Job hath. Therefore take unto you now 7 bullocks and 7 rams, and go to my servant Job, and offer up for yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you. For him will I accept, lest I deal with you after your folly, and in that you have not spoken to me the thing which is right like my servant Job." So God rebukes him. Where did Eliphaz get all of this philosophy? A satanic dream. A spirit passed. He's dreaming. Satan gave him a satanic dream. Now, go with me to Romans chapter 8, and we'll close right here. Just got a minute. Romans in the New Testament here. We begin to find out Romans in the New Testament here. And like for you to notice here, in chapter 8, in verse 3. Romans chapter 8, in verse 3. All right? Or in verse 1. Let's take verse 1, because this verse is many times used for salvation, and it's not speaking about salvation at all. It's speaking about service. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Well, we know that. But let's read the rest of the verse. That verse is quoted in part by so many Baptists that never finish the verse. And they apply it. If you have Christ Jesus, there's no condemnation. That's right. But that's not what this verse is speaking about. If we read the rest. After you're a Christian, you can either sin if you obey the Lord and do righteousness, you're not sinning, right? Isn't that what John said in chapter 3? But he that sinneth is of the devil, because you're obeying the influence the devil has upon your mind to do things contrary to the influence of the Holy Spirit that wants to control your mind and control you to bring you the blessings of God. So, he says here, there's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. This is already a Christian who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So, we have Satan appealing to the flesh. We got the Holy Spirit appealing to try to get you to yield to it. And as Galatians said when Paul wrote to it, the Spirit lusteth against the flesh, flesh against the Spirit. So these two are contrary one to another. Did you ever have somebody tell you, you don't need to go to church? You don't need to do this. You don't need to do that. After all, don't get too religious, you know. And here you're saved. And the Word of God says, don't forsake the assembly of yourselves together. Study the Bible at home. Don't get too busy so you have no time to read the Bible. Study to show thyself approved unto God. A workman that needeth not to be ashamed. You can't be a workman if you don't know anything. You can't be an ignoramus and work because the only thing you do is foul somebody up because you don't know what you're talking about. Amen? So if you know the Word of God, well, praise the Lord. You're on the right road. You'll find out that living after the flesh, you shall die, Satan says. And we find out also Satan appeals to the flesh and to one other thing, our ignorance of the Word of God. Our ignorance. I know one thing, as James, go right on back here to 1 John, and we'll close with this, all right? We just wanted to bring that out and give you just a little bit about here when he talks about here and says, he that committeth sin is of the devil does not mean you're a child of the devil. You'll never cease to be a child of God once you're saved. But it does mean he that sinneth is of the devil, that the devil is behind the motivation that wants you to sin, and he appeals to the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. All three will ruin you if you allow the lust of those to captivate your life, control your life, instead of the Holy Spirit that comes and wants to give you life, not only eternal life, but life more abundantly. Amen. So, John's writing here to open our eyes to let us know Satan wants to destroy you. I want your life, and I want you to have it abundantly. Amen. He just wants us to be aware of our adversary and how tricky this old boy is. You know, just like Ananias and Sapphira, just like David, just like Eliphaz, how he gave him a dream. Can you imagine this? Came to him while he was sleeping and must have done something. Maybe he tickled his nose or something. I don't know what he did, but he put the thoughts in his mind. Part of them were right. Part of them was the Word of God. Part of them was exactly what God would have said. Part of them were lies. But the biggest lie was applying that to a person where it didn't apply and cause all that kind of trouble. Let's just close here this morning, if you will. Our time's gone. The billfold of sin, and I'm a sinner. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ, you can do it right now. And when I trust Christ, I have the sin. If I didn't have sin, I could go to heaven. But since I'm a sinner, and everybody's in the same boat, doesn't it get you sometimes you see these peacocks running around town that act like they're the big boys here, you know? You know what? In God's eyes, they're a sinner on their way to hell. There are no big boys. We've all sinned. And we're in that category too. But I thank God for one thing. I become a child of God instead of a child of Satan. So I don't want to go to hell and pay for my sin. This hand represents Jesus Christ. He died for me, paid for my sin, takes my sin and marks it paid. The minute I put my trust in Him, realizing He paid for my sin on the cross. He paid everything about my right to go to heaven. And all I have to do is receive it as a free gift by accepting and believing the Word of God, which is a record of the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. When I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. Amen. Isn't that wonderful to know? I know I have a home in heaven, and I got to watch out for old Scratch, because he's going to be on my tail to try to lie to me, try to deceive me, and murder my testimony, my life, and foul up all the things that God has for me. The only person that can do it is you, if you listen to Him, instead of listening to what the Lord has to say. We ought to pray, Lord, give me wisdom to know the Word of God, obey the Word of God, and I just want every blessing you have for me. Amen? This is Bound a Word of Prayer. Father, we're grateful to you and we thank you so much. Thank you for the Lord Jesus who loves us. Not only did he die to give us eternal life, he also died on that cross and gives us the Holy Spirit, which guides us in our earthly life. And we need the Holy Spirit. We need that guidance. And thank you for the Word of God, which directs our lives. Dear Father, be with each one here. Give us a wonderful day today. Let us grow as a Christian by reading your Word, not being ignorant of the devices of Satan, not being trapped in his traps that he sets, but also obeying the Word of God. He that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Father, when we're serving and abiding in you, we sinneth not. That's where we want to be as much of the time as we possibly can. Help us to do that in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right. David.